see their faces, but I sure knew the tunes. I'd sing out loud and play pretend guitar on Mama's broom. It drew me like a lighthouse with its tiny amber glow, the best friend of my childhood, my transistor radio.
It's the fifth here, so your album is already being released.
Great. Good, good, good.
And what are you planning on doing on the day?
Well, I'm actually visiting that morning at WSM, the Let's Hear WSM, with those folks and Circle Television. And then in the evening, I'm having rehearsal dinner because my daughter is getting married the next day.
Oh, congratulations. So, yay.
pretty big weekend for
that's
us.
That's definitely a big weekend. Man, oh, man. All right. Well, it sounds like fun anyway. And what's the vibe like in the area? Because here in Auckland, we're still in lockdown mode again. We were pretty cool, and then we got locked down, and we've had enough of it here. So, and people are getting antsy.
You know, it's kind of how it is here too. Honestly, it kind of depends on the political climate of where you are. Some states, depending on their politics, are a little more reserved. I'm in the rural South, so down here people act like they've opted out, you know, that they're back to life, you know. So it's a good thing.
Very good. So the album is called Small Town Dreamer. Just give us a little overview about where and when you recorded it, and kind of the backstory to the record.
One of the great things that COVID brought me in last year was the time to write a lot.
I've been hearing that a lot. Yeah, that's a beautiful thing.
we make good use of that time. So I actually recorded the album back in the spring and early summer at Gorilla's Nest, just north of Nashville. The great Chris Latham at the helm of that, and brought in again my friend Danny Roberts to co-produce with me, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, yep, yep. So what was the vibe like when in the studio?
You know, most of these guys are people that I'd known for a long time or decent known about. So, you know, we have lots of shared experiences and shared stories. And so it's really comfortable. And, you know, we try to cut things as close to live as we possibly can. And
sure.
And where it feels like a performance, and, you know, it takes some work, but it's always worth it.
Yep. And it's kind of based, what you do is based in bluegrass. Kind of, is that how you think of what you do? Did you have an idea coming in of how you wanted to be perceived?
Not really. With me, it's kind of more of a hybrid anymore. I mean, I grew up, like a lot of people, on country music and gospel music in my part of the world. I discovered bluegrass as a young man, as an adult. And so I played that for a lot of years. And so as a songwriter, all of those influences kind of come together. And so it's kind of a hybrid, but, you know, it's still, I get lots of airplay with bluegrass radio, which I appreciate. And there's some straight ahead bluegrass songs on the record, but there's obviously a pretty heavy country influence too.
And a bit of gospel as well, right?
Yeah. Yeah. I always include that. I play a lot of, you know, churches and that sort of thing. So I've always included that. And you know, it's what I try to do as much as anything else with my songs is kind of paint the picture of what it's like in the part of the world that I live in.
Right.
And sort of faith and that sort of thing is part of that.
Right, right, right. So when you paint that picture, what's it like when you take that picture outside of the area and bring it to, say, somebody in California or New York or New Zealand, for that matter?
Well, you know, that's always fun because, you know, we're so used to being around the culture that we live in. And so we all have a tendency to stereotype cultures that we're not as familiar with.
Right.
And, you know, so I've played in places in way north and out west where they would, you know, for my benefit, they would put out hay bales and corn stalks and that sort of thing to try to make me feel at home.
Right.
And they did it. I mean, out of the goodness of their heart, that's just part of the stereotype. And so part of the fun is tearing some of that down, but also playing into that is always fun too.
Did you grow up on a farm?
Yeah, little small farm, you know, I mean, nothing huge. You know, we grew our own vegetables and had cows and pigs and that sort of thing. And I never loved it. My dad loved it better than anything, but it was never my passion. So.
So when did you realize that music was your passion instead?
You know, I was probably, I mean, I can't remember when I wasn't singing, but singing was always important to me. But when I was about 15 or 16, I went to where Loretta Lynn has a ranch just near, not near, here in our county.
Nice.
And as a teenager, I went to work singing out there in the summer. All these tourists would come in and spend a few days, and I would entertain them. And I was like 15 or 16, and my first night there, I sang for an hour. I got paid, and I got a girl's phone number.
Well,
and
there
at that
you
point,
go.
I knew exactly what I wanted to do the rest of my life.
Yeah, done and dusted. I love it. And have you ever regretted it? Have you ever thought I should be doing something else?
You know, not one time. I've done other things at times to supplement music when it was slow. And so I've learned a little bit about a lot of things. But no, it's always been what I love the most and I'm the most passionate about. And it's taken me to places I wouldn't have gone, met people I wouldn't have met. You know, I've got stories that I wouldn't have had. So no, yeah. I can't imagine anything else.
Yeah. So when you perform live, are you performing with a band or you do solo? Or how's it work for you?
Well, it just depends. If I'm doing a festival, a big event, I do have a band that I carry. I do lots of songwriter events, songwriter festivals, churches, and that sort of thing. And most of those I just do solo. And so it's kind of the best of both worlds.
Cool, cool. And I see you have Jay Lee Roberts and Jeanette Williams singing a little harmony throughout with you. Tell me about them and how you guys work together. Get your voices to play.
Jeanette and her husband, Johnny, have been friends of mine for many, many years. And Jeanette's a great vocalist, great talent. And so I always enjoyed having her come in. Jay Lee is unique because, like I said, her dad, Danny, and I were in a band together back in the 90s. So I have literally known her entire life.
Oh,
and
yeah?
To see her as this young woman now with this incredible amount of talent and promise and to have her as a part of my project, but also cheering her on in her own musical endeavors. That's pretty cool. I like that.
Excellent. Now I see you have a tune called The Waverly Train Disaster, which there's got to be a story behind that, obviously. Tell us all about it.
Yeah, when I was just a kid here in Waverly, we have a train that runs parallel with town and a train derailed, and part of the cars that came off of that was a couple of propane tankers, and one of those, it ultimately exploded and killed a number of people and did a lot of damage. And I had for a long time wanted to write a song about that, and I wanted to write it in the old style. I love the old tragedy songs like the West Virginia mining disaster and the wreck of the old seven and those kind of. So I wanted to write one kind of in that vein So I was real, real proud that I got to include that on the album.
Right. Well, speaking of old style, I see that your writing has been compared to Don Williams by somebody who wrote something about you.
Yeah.
So is that an accurate assessment of you and how
you
write yourself?
I would hope so, really. I mean, that's such a huge compliment. I was heavily influenced by, he was my favorite growing up and, you know, very laid back personality, which I also have. And he appreciates simplicity and that sort of thing. And so there's lots of overlap there. And so, yeah, I take that as a huge compliment.
So when you approach a song, say Hillbilly Dust, what do you start with? Is it a chord progression? Is it a couple of lyrics? How do you get into it?
Most of the time, the lyric comes first, but just barely, because once I start with a lyric or two, I basically just start singing and trying to find a lyric that fits that meter and fits the melody. And then when I start getting close, then I'll grab a guitar and start trying to find the chords and the keys and kind of go from there. But for the most part, they write themselves at the same time, but the lyric's always just a little bit ahead.
Cool. Now I see you have a guitar in your hand. Are you thinking of performing a song?
You know, that's funny. I grab it all the time. This is a little parlor guitar, a little Fender guitar I got when I was about 14 years old, got for Christmas.
Really?
I keep it here. It's what I write with. It's not the one I perform with, but it's my actual songwriting guitar. So.
Very good.
A lot of the songs on this album were written on this very little parlor guitar.
See, this is what I love about Zoom. People get weird about, but you really get an intimate feel for, you know, you get to see people's studios, meet their cats and dogs, and see their guitars.
Right.
So in general, how has the last year been for you? You say you've got a time to write, which is definitely a plus, but otherwise, people around you, are they kind of dealing with it well, or are they okay, or stressing?
Yeah, I mean, I mean, it was obviously a huge setback for people in my world, you know, and a lot of people took on some serious financial hardships by not being able to work. A lot of people think that, you know, that you make a lot of money off of, you know, record sales and airplay, and independent artists typically don't. I mean, you make your living off the road. And when the road is not there, it's a struggle. So yeah, we're absolutely glad to see the world starting to open back up again.
That's good. And there's a couple of tunes that you co-wrote with a person named R. Lang, like a Transistor Radio, which leads off the album. So tell me how the two of you work together.
Rick is a wonderful guy. Rick Lang lives up in New Hampshire, and we met at the International Bluegrass Music Association convention a couple of years ago, and just hit it off. And so we started writing over the computer, you know, like you and I are doing now. We just log on together and just write. And he's just, it's funny because we come from different parts of the country and different cultures in a way, but we're also very much kindred spirits in the things that are important to us. So writing with Rick is easy and fun, and he is so passionate about it. He's the one that'll always say, man, we need to write this week. We got to write this week. And I appreciate that because he pushes me and makes sure that I'm staying focused, and that helps a lot.
Cool. Now, bluegrass in general seems to be having some kind of groundswell. Maybe it's just me, but I've been talking to a lot of pickers and grinners lately, and there's a guy like Billy Strings seems to be kind of, although to me, he sounds like he's doing more than just bluegrass, but that's beside the point, I guess. So what does it feel like to you?
You know, I think it's the funny thing is that bluegrass is the term, but it encompasses so many different types of styles, and it's almost like if the instruments are acoustic, we can consider it part of the family. And you know, some of the purists struggle with that a little bit. I don't, you know, because I just think people who are creating music are creating, you know, what's important to them, and it's a part of their life, and it's coming out of their spirit, and that every great music that we've ever had in the past came that way.
Yeah.
It came from being influenced from the music behind it, and it pushed into something new that was incredible, and I would hate to miss out on that by trying to hold the reins back on it.
I mean, I think to me, it's just, everything is under the umbrella of Americana these days, whether it's country or bluegrass or, you know, rhythm and blues or whatever. I don't know. It just seems to be more. Well, and there's a lot of blurring.
I agree. And it allows artists to, you know, to have some freedom to express themselves the way they want and write and record the way they want. And I'm highly in favor of that.
So do you feel like, is there a group of people, musicians, other artists that you feel a part of, or you're in a kind of group mentality with?
You know, I guess more than anything else, I consider myself a songwriter, a singer-songwriter. Right. And some of my better friends are also people like that. You know, folks like Jerry Sally and Irene Kelly and, you know, a lot of other who are friends of mine, but I'm also a huge fan of their music. And that's always fun, too, to be able to know them personally and bring them into whatever you're doing, but also to be kind of able to stand at the sidelines and cheer them on because you're a fan of what they do.
Right. So you kind of touched on the fact that you don't make a lot of money making records and blah, blah, blah. What do you kind of hope for when this record comes out tomorrow for you and what it accomplishes?
You know, more than anything else, like I said, I love writing about the little small town that I live in, the people here, you know, this way of life. And
right.
And it doesn't lean real heavy on the stereotype. I mean, most of it is pretty true to life as the way things are. And I didn't necessarily start out writing a concept record, but that is kind of the thread that weaves itself through the entire project. And
right.
And so, you know, that to me, that's just that's important to me, to be able to leave a musical legacy about the part of the world that, is most important to me.
Right. Well, it's interesting. Small town. I grew up in small town, Pennsylvania, believe it or not. In a very small town. It was like 500 people. And this is back in the 1960s. So I think I kind of have my own idea of what small town USA is like from back then. But do you think it's changed much? Is it different now than maybe it was in the past? Is it going through any kind of evolution?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure obviously it's changing, you know, because, you know, with the internet and that sort of thing, people have access to the world in ways that they didn't used to.
Yeah.
And sometimes that's not necessarily a good thing, but it's also, on the other side of that, people have the opportunity now more than ever to work from home and then live wherever they want to. And so people who want to live and you know, I can sit here in my office and on a pretty day, I can see kids on their bicycles riding down to the milkshake store. And that's just the world that we're living.
Yep.
And so now people have the opportunity to, you know, I want to live in a place like that and without having to change jobs and all of that. And so I think that's a good thing.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, that sounds pretty much like what I was doing growing up in Pennsylvania. It was like milkshakes and riding a bicycle and playing baseball.
Yeah, that's kind of what it is like here. You know, we're about an hour west of Nashville and about 2 hours east of Memphis. So we're far enough from the big cities. It's not super convenient to live here and work in the town. Some people do, but it's not super convenient. So a lot of people live here. They have either have roots here or they live here on purpose, you know, because it is a little bit removed from some of the changes that other communities have seen. It's, you know, the wheel of time and is a little behind us on here. And I like that.
So do you ever get the urge to move to Memphis or Nashville and be in the big city?
No, not really. I mean, I love going there and I love traveling and I love, you know, experiencing what the cities have. And I like being close enough that I can drive to either one for a concert or for a weekend or whatever, and then come back home. So to me, I kind of have both sides of that. So I'm close enough I can experience it, but far enough away that I don't feel like I have to be living in that, you know, that speed of life all the time.
Oh, that's cool. Well, it's getting a little speedy for you this weekend. You got a record coming out and a daughter you're sending off. Man, oh man.
Yeah, that's quite a weekend. It's, you know, I had to take the weekend off. I've got the album comes out. And then I've got my daughter married on Saturday. And so, you know, lots of family coming into town for that. So it's going to be a busy weekend.
So in a family event like a wedding, is there a lot of music?
Well, it's funny. I don't really know this. I only have one daughter. I have two sons. They are not married. This is my first wedding.
Right.
So we'll see. You know, she's got it planned out. So, you know, my job is to show up, be clean shaven, be ready to go. You know,
I'll be there. Maybe bring your guitar with you just in case.
Well, you know, I may have just in case. I've had a number of people say, are you going to sing at the wedding? Are you going to write her a song? No, I couldn't do it. I'm too emotional. I'd never get through, you know.
Yep.
And she's already made me promise not to cry. So I'm going to get
That's, you got to go for it. Yep. All right. Well, thank you very much for talking to me about the record. Hope it does well. Have a great weekend. And everything happens the way it should.
Well, I appreciate it. So good to see you. Thank you so much.
You too. Bye-bye.